Think we can do it? Do you have something to say? What do you want to say today? Did you forget?
Uh-huh.
You gonna go sit there with Dad? You don't? Good. I was just thinking, as Pastor Steve was talking about lawnmowers, that maybe we need to put some rubber things on our lawnmower so they'll do a little hydro thing, you think? Think that would be good? So do you know where we're going to preach from today? Don't know? Can you say? You have to say it really loud.
Tell them.
Esther.
What?
Esther.
Esther.
How about if you go there?
Wow, is that it?
Did you sign up? I mean, you know, come on, Grandpa can't refuse when he comes and sits on my lap during prayer time and says, I want to be with you. I want to tell you a little bit of a story today as we begin this message this morning on Mother's Day. And Mike, I realized that while I was sitting there, I never took you the sermon notes. So just do what you would like with the slides are there. That's good. I'll try to give you a few hints if you didn't get that will help you along the way. Or maybe Nathan got them to you, I'm not sure. The story took place many, many thousands of years ago. And the king was a fellow by the name of Xerxes. I like Xerxes too. We've been reading about Didymus and Thomas, also known as Didymus, and so I would ask you to help me say his name just because I like to hear it, Didymus. And this name is just as good, Xerxes. Xerxes. King Xerxes, he enjoyed his life. And it actually came to a point in his kingdom that he decided he wanted everyone to know how important he was, how special he was, how significant he was. He wanted everyone just to know everything that he could tell them, and so he planned a party, a big party, a party that would last, according to the scriptures, almost 7 days long. That's a long party. I don't know that I could handle it, but King Xerxes, he made it. And unfortunately, in the midst of their partying, they enjoyed drinking their wine, it tells us in scriptures, and they got drunk. And as we know, that oftentimes when people get drunk, they don't always make the best of decisions. And King Xerxes made a decision in his condition that he thought that his queen, Queen Vashti, ought to come and dance for everybody. So he sent a message, got out his phone and text, and said, send in Queen Vashti, dress her all up, make her look pretty as she is, and bring her out and so that she can dance in front of me and all of my fellow rulers. Queen Vashti got the text, and she said to the people that delivered it, the attendants, you tell the king I'm not going to do that. She refused to come, the story says. Word came back to King Xerxes. And in his condition, it says that he got furious and he was angry. And in the midst of that, he called together all of his smart people, and they had a little conference call. And the conference went on, what should I do with Queen Vashti? She's not going to dance for us. Well, these guys begin to talk. Well, if the king's wife doesn't do what he tells her to, and the word gets out to my wife, that's not going to be a good thing. And we'll have a whole bunch of ladies that aren't doing what they're supposed to be doing. And so the king's attendants, his advisor, said to him, King Xerxes, you need to banish her from the kingdom. You need to take away her royal kingdom. You need to take away everything from her to teach everyone a lesson that you are the king. So King Xerxes did just that. He banished Vashti from the kingdom, took away her royal robe, her crown, everything from her. A few weeks later, King Xerxes maybe is in a little better condition in his mind, and he begins to think about what he had done, and he began to realize, this probably wasn't a good idea. I no longer have a queen. So he called his servants together and said, hey guys, I want you to put together the best beauty pageant that you can ever put together so that I can pick out a new queen. They said, okay. So they began to call in all the pretty girls. And they began to, for a whole year, they did all the fancy stuff. Ladies, how would you like to go to a 365-day spa? I probably didn't want to hear that. So these ladies all gather together, and they do all of the stuff to get them prettied up and make them look good and all that kind of stuff, and then they have a parade in front of the king. One young lady, a Jew, stands out. Her name was Esther. Esther walks in front of King Xerxes, and he says, oh, stop! We can end the parade right here. She is the most beautiful thing I've ever seen. I want her to be my queen. And so Esther was chosen, crowned as queen of Persia, and she began her kingdom, her reign as queen to King Xerxes. Well, in the meantime now, King Xerxes is still associating with different rulers, and there's another young ruler coming up by the name of Haman. Haman has an attitude, and he thinks he's about it. And so Haman begins to look around the kingdom, and he begins to see different groups of people, and he sees this gentleman, and I'm adding a little bit to the story, but he sees this gentleman named Mordecai, and he doesn't like Mordecai. And he begins to do a little research and find out that Mordecai is a Jew, and they're kind of part of the remnant. Many of the Jews had gone back to Jerusalem to rebuild, but there was this group of Jews that had stayed in there, and Mordecai was hanging around the kingdom all the time because he happened to be the guardian. He was related to Esther. And so he was concerned about what was going on within Esther's life. And Haman didn't like Mordecai. So, some of you remember the story. Haman goes in and he visits, sits down, and they have this little powwow with King Xerxes. And Haman says, you know what? You need to get rid of all of these people that are kind of lording around the palace. We just need to get rid of all these Jews, because they don't worship you. They don't recognize you as king. They have some other god that they worship, and they need to recognize that you are the king. You are the all-powerful one. Xerxes, he kind of liked that whole concept. And so when Haman brought in the decree, he put the official stamp, Xerxes put the official stamp on the decree that was going to kill all of the Jews. And Haman so despised Mordecai that he made a special hanging point to kill Mordecai. But Mordecai is out in the street and he begins to hear about all of this. He and his fellow Jews, and they become concerned about their very life. And as you read through the story, Mordecai sends word to Queen Esther. Hey, Esther, you need to be aware of what's going on in your world. You see, Esther, they didn't know she was a Jew, and she was kind of set aside. She was kind of put back in seclusion because she was the queen. So she wasn't really aware of everything that was going on around her, which comes to my first point today as we think about living out our faith in our world. If we place ourselves in isolation and seclusion from the church, from the world, from the body of Christ, we will miss the opportunity to make an impact in our world. You see, if Queen Esther would have just stayed in her little throne room and just stayed back there, just waiting for the king to call her, she would have not known what was going on, and she would not have made any difference in her world because she wasn't aware of the situation. And I believe that you and I should not isolate ourselves from the church or from the world. We need to make ourselves available because we have within us, as a follower and a believer in Christ, we have the very presence and the essence of the Almighty God that says, I will be with you. I will never leave you nor forsake you. And so I believe that you and I need to not live in isolation. We need not to enclose ourselves into the walls of the church, but we need to get out into our community. And we need to live as if Christ lives in us. And let them see Jesus in us. So Esther gets the word there in her isolated room that the Jews are in danger. Her people have a problem. So she has this conversation with Mordecai. And Mordecai says, Queen Esther, you need to do something about this. I want us to think for a moment, two thoughts from Mordecai's decision to connect with his relative Esther. The first one is this: he was desperate. His life was in danger. He was desperate. Because he knew if something didn't change, he would be the one that would be hung for the whole community to see. He was desperate. And I wonder sometimes if we, the people of God, ever get desperate enough for God's love to connect with those around us, to be willing to step out into faith doing what he would ask us to do. Or are we just content and comfortable in our nice little surroundings? And we're really not desperate for those who are struggling and living in hopelessness in our world. Mordecai became desperate enough that he was willing to risk his life to get word to the queen. Secondly, he cared enough about his relative to get word to her. He cared enough. And I sometimes wonder, church, do we care enough about those that are living around us that seem to not know Jesus, that seem to be in a situation where their world is crumbling down upon them? Do we care enough to invest ourselves into their lives? Mordecai did. He cared enough. He was desperate enough. So Queen Esther came to a point in this journey that she had to make a decision. And she carried on this conversation with Mordecai and said, "Now, Mordecai, do you realize that as queen, I don't have just unlimited access to the king? In fact, I have to wait until the red phone rings and he calls me and calls me up to his place." And Mordecai said to Queen Esther, "You have to do something. You have to be willing to invest your life, yourself, to do this." Queen Esther began to make a plan. And that plan involved willingness and sacrifice. Willingness and sacrifice. Now, I want to say to us, the church, how willing are we to become involved in the nitty-gritty, messy stuff of life to make a difference in His kingdom? It's pretty easy for us to say, "Well, I'll let so-and-so do it." It's pretty easy for us to be kind of like Moses and say, "Well, you know, I don't speak very well, and so I don't think that I really have the ability to get out there and do anything, and so we just kind of live our life, coming to church, singing our couple of courses or our couple of hymns, and listening to a few prayers, putting in our offerings." And maybe even some of us, we get really bold and we say, "Well, I'll teach that Sunday school class, or I'll sing in the choir." But my question is, am I really willing to become involved in the nitty-gritty, messy things of life and say, "Okay, God, you speak, and I will go"? By the way, do you know in the book of Esther, God is not mentioned? Now, it's implied continually in the sovereignty of God and God's hand at work, but God Himself is never mentioned. But I believe that God used Mordecai to speak into Queen Esther's life and to challenge her to be willing to make a difference in the kingdom to save the remnant of the people of God. Esther was willing. And then we also discover that not only was she willing to be available, she was willing to sacrifice. She was willing to give of herself to make a difference and save the people. And I wonder sometimes, how much am I willing to sacrifice? Again, I'm pretty comfortable, I'm pretty content. But as we discover God's call in our life, friends, God didn't call us to be Americans. God has called us to be His followers, to take up His cross and to follow Him day after day. And to be willing to stand up for what we know is right because we have read Scripture and we have heard the voice of God through His book, through His people, and we are willing to offer ourselves and to give ourselves sacrificially. And that's one of the things I like about this church. I have seen that over and over and over again. You are a willing people. You are a people who sacrifice over and over again. Thank you for that. But we must never be content. I don't know that our willingness and our sacrifice will ever end. It will be a point where we have to continually hear the voice of God speaking to us and making ourselves available and saying, here I am, I will go. We cannot live in isolation. We cannot live a secluded life. We must make ourselves available and believe that the God who created all of the universe will go with us. He will go before us. He will come behind us, and he will help us to care enough and to be desperate enough, to be willing and to offer ourselves even as a sacrifice so that he can use us to make a difference in his kingdom. I'd like you to take your Bibles and turn to the book of Esther. It's not quite halfway through the book. Esther chapter 4, beginning at verse 12. May this be the challenge for us on this Mother's Day. When you have found it, I invite you to stand in honor of the reading of the Word of God. Verse 12. When Esther's words were reported to Mordecai, he sent back this answer. Do not think that because you are in the king's house, you alone of all the Jews will escape. For if you remain silent at this time, relief and deliverance for the Jews will arise from another place. But you and your father's family will perish. And all who knows, and who knows but that you have come to your royal position for such a time as this. Then Esther sent this reply to Mordecai. Go, gather together all the Jews who are in Susa and fast for me. Do not eat or drink for 3 days, nights or day, and I and my attendants will fast as you do. When this is done, I will go to the king, even though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish. The word of the Lord. Father, we have heard the story today. We have been reminded of a few incredible lessons from your recorded word. And I pray, Lord, that somehow in the midst of this journey, we will open our minds to understand that the story is not just an account for back then, but it also is designed to teach us about how we live out our faith today. And so, Lord, I would pray that we would make ourselves available. And for all the little calibers that are going to grow up in the sphere of our influence, I would pray that we would be desperate enough for their safety and their care. We would care enough about them that we are willing to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, and that we would be willing to declare as Esther, if I perish, I perish. But if you can use me, Lord, here am I. Help me to go and to do and to be available for whatever you would ask of us. Oh Lord, would you help us not to be a church that is focused on ourselves, but would you help us to be a people who have been so transformed by the grace and the mercy of your Son, Jesus Christ, that we will take your grace and that we will take your mercy and go out into our neighborhoods, into our workplaces, into our schools, and we will be willing to say, here am I. Use me, dear God, to make a difference, to make a difference in my community, in the circle of influence in which I live, for your kingdom's sake. I pray these things in the name of Jesus, my Lord and my Savior. Amen. Amen. You are dismissed. Go in the grace and the peace of our Lord and Savior. Comments that you would like to make, or anything that you would like to tell what God is doing in your life, please.
Sometimes it feels like I'm watching from the outside. Sometimes it feels like I'm breathing.
Thank you for watching today online. It has been our privilege to share this time with you. I'm Pastor Terry Armstrong, and I want you to know that if we can do anything to assist you, any words that you would like to say, any comments that you would like to make, or anything that you would like to tell us about what God is doing in your life, please do not hesitate to give us a call. Our number is 405-376-2892. Or you can email me directly at terry@mustangnaz.org. Again, we just hope that today, your spirit, your heart has been encouraged by the presence of God. And so now I just want to say to you, may the peace of our Lord and Savior reign and rule, and may He give you His calmness in the midst of your storms. In Christ's name we pray these things for you. Amen.